just check. Check.
Thank you.
Very good morning to brothers and sisters in Christ. Welcome back to Prinsep Street Presbyterian Church. And also for those who are joining us online, welcome to join us virtually. A few reminders before we begin our service today that we should always keep our mask on as during the service, except when we are taking the communion. And also that during the song, during the singing of the hymns, reminder that congregation, you should refrain from singing, but rather to join us in singing it silently in your heart. And also that after the service, that please refrain from mingling with either within or outside at the front of the church. And the last reminder is for those who are worshiping with us at home. Today is Communion Sunday, so please prepare the elements of communion before we start the service. And now let's quiet our hearts and allow the choir to minister to us through the introit. Being the second Sunday of the Advent season, we're going to light the Advent candle now. Once again, we light the first candle of our Advent wreath, the candle of hope. Remembering that Christ will come again to bring salvation to all who are waiting for Him. Today, we also light the second candle, the candle of peace. This candle reminds us that Jesus is the Prince of Peace and that true peace is found only in Him. Let us worship today and every day, celebrating the peace that surpasses understanding. Christ came more than 2,000 years ago to bring peace between sinners and the Holy God. But God demonstrates His own love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. This is following the today's call to worship, Romans chapter 5, verse 1, which says, "Therefore, since we have been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Because of Christ's sacrifice, we are restored to a relationship of peace with God. This is the deep, abiding peace between our hearts and our Creator that cannot be taken away. Yet we still live in a fallen world, awaiting the second coming of Christ. So while we wait and watch, let us recall the time when the world waited with abated breath, the birth of the promised Messiah. As we sing our Advent hymn today, Watchmen, tell us of the night. Let us ponder over the words and offer up the song as our personal prayer to God, our Father. So let's stand and remember we shall just sing this quietly in our hearts.
Traveler o'er yon mountain tide,
Let's go to God in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we come before you with awe and wonder as we celebrate Christmas. The very thought that Christ's birth was preordained since the dawn of life and the purpose of his birth totally bewilders the mortal mind. How awesome and deep is your love for us indeed. Father God, you are love, and Christ was given to us out of your boundless love, so that we can come back to you as sinless as when you designed us in your heart so long ago. Father, as we remain watchful in this fallen world, we take joy in the remembrance of our Lord Jesus' birth and the promises it brings. We come today to both remember Christ's birth in the lighting of the candles and also Christ's death in the sharing of the bread and wine. Speak to us through the songs, prayers, and words from the pulpit, O Lord, so we may reaffirm our love and commitment to you. For this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. And before we continue with our service, let us spend the next few moments in silent prayer to ask God to search our hearts for any ways that we have failed Him, and we ask for His forgiveness. Let's bring our prayer to a close. Let's read the prayer of confession together as a church. Lord of life, we come to you consumed by our worry and our pain. We too often blame you for not being there in our need, rather than turning to you for help in the moments of loss. Help us put our faith in your promise of healing and life. Teach us anew that you are the resurrection and the life. Help us remember that you show compassion when we weep and seek to lead us to newness of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. God is a loving and forgiving God, for his longing to forgive us when we come to him. For it says in Psalm 103, verses 11 and 12, "For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us." Let's hold this promise of pardon in our hearts as we go through life, as we go through our day-to-day challenges. And so now, as people who have been purified and justified by faith, let us now rise and greet each other with a smile or wave your hands and welcome each other as fellow brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you. I'm really longing for the day that we can actually really shake hands and even to hug each other, but that day will come. Jesus has been consistently ranked among the most influential people in history. Humanly speaking, the world would be vastly, unimaginably different if Jesus had not come. Yet this man who literally upended the world was born no different from you and I, except the fact that he wasn't delivered by a trained medical professional in the comfort of the hospitals, but rather it was in a miserable manger surrounded by animals. Yet Jesus went on to accomplish the greatest, the most amazing feat of all, and that's to bring mankind back to God. As we meditate over this next Christmas hymn, "What Child Is This?", let us listen with amazement and in worship of Jesus Christ, the King, the Babe, the Prince of Peace. Let us rise.
Gold and pearl, come one and all. redemption brings. Let now being God's enthroned here. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing.
Please be seated. Indeed, as we let this very familiar yet very haunting tune linger in our hearts, let us continue our worship with our offering. So, for those of you who are present with us here, you can hold on to your offering and you can deposit your offering into the offering box before you leave the sanctuary. While those who are worshiping with us at home, you can follow the instructions on screen to give your offering, to give an e-offering. Or if you prefer, you can put your offering in the envelope, and when you come back to church to worship, you can deposit also in the offering box. Let us all rise for the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy.
Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for your abundant grace and mercy. When we were still weak and hopelessly trapped in sin, you gave your most precious Son to us so that we can have eternal life. And now, as a sign of our gratitude for your grace and mercy, we offer up our humble offering of our heart, our life, and our gift. Bless this offering, so that your kingdom among your people and the earth can continue to grow. Teach us to use this money wisely for your kingdom, so that all men wise and simple may know you and acknowledge you as Lord. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated.
Peace be with you, my brothers and sisters who are on site and those who are online. It is my joy to be here standing before you and testify God's faithfulness for all your prayers for the treatment. Praise God, hallelujah. For the church news, please refer to page 7 of the bulletin. Item number 1, PSPC Christmas service. This Christmas, on 25th of December, Saturday, we will be having our service at 10 a.m. There will be a pre-recorded Joyful Voices item, as well as the children's sermonette. We will also be witnessing the infant baptism. The service will be on live stream with one zone of 100 fully vaccinated congregants in this sanctuary. We will announce the booking of seats in middle of December. Item number 5, PSPC on-site and live stream Holy Communion. Today, as the first Sunday of the month, we will have Holy Communion on-site and on live stream. For those who are participating online, please prepare the bread, wine, or juice. After the sermon, Pastor Daryl will lead us to partake the Holy Communion. Last, on page 8, we have a flyer of donations for the upcoming Angels Trees movie. This is organized by the Prison Fellowship Singapore to support the inmates, ex-offenders, and their families. May the Lord help us to give generously as all our blessings comes from Him. Let us prepare our hearts for prayer. Our Father in heaven, we commit our ministry, our families, and the world before your throne of grace. For our ministry, PSPC on-site congregations. Lord, we thank you for the expansions of on-site congregationals' capacity for the English service. We also rejoice in resuming Mandarin service on-site today. Lord, continue to help us to worship you in spirit and in truth. For our family, we want to lift up Adriel and Connie Sabalas. We thank you for our missionaries who are serving in the Philippines. We give you thanks that they were able to minister at the Bible School Mission Week. We pray that the attendees will respond to your call and make an impact for your kingdom. We also commit Kara and Calvin that they will complete their study and for your leading as the family prepare to relocate to another city. Gracious God, you are our healer. We commit our brothers and sisters who need your healing grace today. For Lim Heng Ho, husband of Su Jing, Lord, we thank you for your faithfulness upon him. We pray that you will give Heng Ho strength and complete healing as he recovers at home. We also pray for Su Jing that you will sustain her as she cares for her husband. For Paul Chin, husband of Anna, we praise you for his recovery after his surgery. We continue to pray for your healing and improvement of his heart condition. We also pray for Anna that you will grant her strength as she cares for her husband. For Susan Leong, we thank you for your sustaining grace. Lord, we pray that you will give her the strength to complete healing as she recovers at home. For our world, we lift up the people of Myanmar. Lord, they've gone through so much pain as they face political, economic, and pandemic turmoils. We pray that in the midst of devastation, your people will continue to look unto you with hope because you are able and you're willing to save them. Jesus, our Prince of Peace, we pray that you will restore the peace within their hearts and in their land. Let us take a moment of silence and bring our needs to God before we end to meditate the lyrics of the Lord's Prayer. To our great God, who love us with an everlasting love, we entrust all our prayers into your sovereign hands. In the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray.
See you. scripture reading for this morning is from Luke chapter 1, verses 67 to 79. Luke chapter 1, verse 67. And his father, Zechariah, was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesied, saying, Blessed be the Lord God of Israel, for he has visited and redeemed his people, and has raised up a horn of salvation for us in the house of his servant David, as he spoke by the mouth of his holy prophets from of old, that we should be saved from our enemies and from the hand of all who hate us, to show the mercy promised to our fathers and to remember his holy covenant, the oath that he swore to our father Abraham, to grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear, in holiness and righteousness before him all our days. And you, child, will be called the prophet of the Most High, for you will go before the Lord to prepare his ways, to give knowledge of salvation to his people in the forgiveness of their sins, because of the tender mercy of our God, whereby the sunrise shall visit us from on high, to give light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, to guide our feet into the peace, into the way of peace. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Very good morning, my brothers and sisters. It's an honor and privilege to be standing here again, to be a channel of God's word to you on site and online. Today is the second Sunday of Advent, and so may the Lord prepare our hearts and minds to receive his word and remember the joyous occasion of the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray. God our Father, write the truth of your word in our hearts, and that it may convict us, challenge us, and change us. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be pleasing in your sight. O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. When I was a chaplain intern, I was attached to a nursing home for a short period of time. I remember once I was having a conversation with a resident by the name of Mr. Wong. He was in his late 70s. He was in a nursing home because of his weak legs and therefore is at risk for falls. When I entered his ward, I saw that he was the only one in the ward. The rest were out doing their daily activities. I approached him, pulled up a chair, and sat next to his bed. He was in a good mood that morning, so I started a conversation with him, asking him if he slept well and how he was feeling. And since it was my third visit to him, Mr. Wong started to open up and share more about his thoughts and personal life. He shared that he has been yearning for his children to get married. Both his children are in their 50s and are still single. He reasoned that it is only when the children are married, then he will stop worrying if they are not married. Because if they are not married, who will take care of them in their old age? So I replied, Mr. Wong, after they get married, you will have nothing to worry about, right? He said, no more, nothing to worry anymore. He paused, and he continued, except maybe their health. One of them has diabetes. Okay, so you worry for their health as well. I repeated after him. And he said, their work is also unstable and they don't earn a lot. So I also worry if they have enough to spend. Now, many of us can relate to Mr. Wong. We worry daily and our list of worries is endless. We may worry about our health, parents' health, about children's studies and many, many other things. It is so natural for us to worry that some of us even worry about others not being worried. Parents will ask their children, hey, why are you not studying? Are you not worried about your exams? Or some of us worry about being constantly worried. Is there an end to this? Can we truly be free from worries? Scripture tells us not to be anxious about anything because worrying does not help the situation. And we may never truly be free from worries if we address every worry as a problem that needs to be solved. Even if Mr. Wang's children got married, he would still worry about their health and their employment. But rather than being anxious about circumstances, we know we can seek God and He will grant that peace which surpasses all understanding that will guard our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. But what is this peace, my brothers and sisters? And if it surpasses understanding, are we still able to talk about it? Perhaps the prophet Zechariah has something for us today when we read that the finale of his prophetic song is about peace. In music, the finale is the end of a piece of composition. It can be the highlight of the piece, but it surely is the conclusion. And Zechariah's song culminates into a finale on the theme of peace. Before we examine Zechariah's song, let us first explore the context of this passage. The passage today is called the Benedictus. It is Zechariah's prophetic song. Earlier in Luke chapter 1, we are told that the angel Gabriel appeared to Zechariah to announce that he would have a son, and he would name him Jesus. He would name him John. But due to Zechariah's unbelief when he questioned the announcement, he was made unable to speak until his son was born. Now, after the birth of his son, Zechariah was asked to name him on the day of the baby boy's circumcision. And he wrote on a writing tablet, "His name is John." As soon as that happened, he became filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak and prophesy. And this is the passage for the sermon today. The song of Zechariah is arranged neatly into two parts. In part one, from verse 68 to 75, Zechariah praised God for his faithfulness to his people. In part two, from verse 76 to 79, Zechariah gave a broad description of his son's role. Let us turn to our Bible and look at part one, which is verse 68 to 75. Immediately when Zechariah's lips were freed to speak, he first praised God with a long sentence. And in that sentence, Zechariah gave reasons why God should be praised. The promised time of salvation has already come, and it will be fulfilled by the future work of the Son of God, who is also referred here as the horn of salvation. The imagery of the horn symbolizes the strength of an animal, and in connection with the house of the servant David, it can only refer to the coming Messiah, Jesus Christ. And that the coming of Christ was a fulfillment of the covenantal promises God made to the prophets of the Old Testament. Zechariah then continued to share the anticipation of being rescued from Israel's enemies and those who hate the people of God. Now, this is not understood as a political or national deliverance from enemies, but rather as an Old Testament metaphorical description of personal salvation from sin and judgment. In this part of Zechariah's song, the promise of God's mercy and his covenant with Abraham was also recalled. These key words in verse 68, 71, and 74, describes God's faithfulness to Israel. God redeemed his people. He saved them from their enemies and from the hand of all who hated them. He delivered them from the hand of their enemies. It is amazing that the first words that come out of Zechariah were praises for God's redemptive work and his faithfulness in the past. With the recollection of how God redeemed his people, saved and delivered Israel from the hands of the enemies, it informs those who come after them that they may serve God without fear, in holiness and righteousness for the rest of their lives. The recollection of God's redemptive work in the past gives us the assurance of his redemptive work in the present and into the future. There is a mouthful, but what does it mean for us today? Can we recall how we come we came into the faith, can we recall our own baptism? Or perhaps we can recall something that happened in the past which caused us to trust Him for the present and the future. I can. Till this day, I am reminded of His faithfulness by the burn scars I have on my left hand and on my right leg. When I see these scars, I am reminded how God sent help to us after the accident happened, and how I did not feel afraid, but strangely assured that everything will be all right. Another way to remind ourselves of God's faithfulness is to flip through our past journal entries so that we can look back and see God's hand at work in our lives. This is also like when we drive, we check our rearview mirror and side mirrors to give us information on the traffic condition. We check backwards as we move forward. But regardless of what you do, do take time to reflect as the year comes to a close. The recollection of God's redemptive work in the past gives us the assurance for His redemptive work in the present and into the future. Our personal experience of God's faithfulness in the past gives us the assurance that come what may, God will surely see us through it. The next part of Zechariah's prophetic song from verse 76 reveals to us the role of John the Baptist as the one who will go before the Lord to prepare His ways. God will make John His prophet, but the one whom John will prepare the way for will be the Son of God. But how does John the Baptist prepare the way for the Lord Jesus? Verse 77 explains this for us. John the Baptist is to give knowledge of salvation through the forgiveness of sins. In other words, John's role is to preach that the experiencing of this salvation is by means of repentance and forgiveness of sins. Luke helps us clarify this further in chapter 3, verses 2 and 3. The word of God came to John and the son of Zechariah, in the wilderness, and he went into all the region around the Jordan, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. The use of the metaphor sunrise in verse 78 and it dawning upon us from on high, shining light into those living in darkness and in the shadow of death, very likely refers to the works of the coming Messiah. Matthew also wrote of this in Matthew chapter 4, verse 16. The people dwelling in darkness have seen a great light, and for those dwelling in the region and shadow of death, on them a light has dawned. The sun, the bright morning light, comes from heaven and shines on those in darkness and death, guiding them into the path of peace. Now, while the first part of Zechariah's song tells us about God's faithfulness in the past, assuring us of our present and future, the second part tells us that the role of John the Baptist is to prepare and point to the coming Messiah who will guide those in darkness into the way of peace. But for us today, how do our lives point to the Lord Jesus? Do we point to Jesus by our speech or by our actions or both? In my secondary school days, there was this school admin staff. Whenever she talked to a student, she would always say, "Boy, Jesus loves you." Every opportunity she had, she would remind us of Jesus' love. During recess break, she would look for an empty seat in the cafeteria next to a group of students who were having the meal. She would sit herself down and say to the group, "Boys, do you know Jesus loves you?" And she did it so often that when the boys see her coming, they would take their food and leave their table. But you know, since I am a nice boy, I found it very rude to leave the table when she joined us. So as a result, I often ended up sitting with her and listening to her stories during my recess break. I suppose that could be one of the reasons why I'm standing here today. Now, Jesus loves you. Saying those three words is her way of pointing the students to the Lord. How about you? Now, I'm not saying everyone must adopt this practice to point others to Jesus, But perhaps this is something worth thinking about. How would your words and actions point others to Jesus? And so as we point others to Jesus, we are also showing them into the path of peace. But perhaps we should first answer this question. What is peace? Many of us know that the peace which the Bible speaks of has its root meaning from the Hebrew word shalom, as wholeness or well-being. In the Old Testament, shalom, peace, is mostly used to mean peace as opposed to war, concord as opposed to strife, prosperity and success, welfare, state of health, friendliness, deliverance, or salvation. God is also said to be a God of peace, one who dispenses peace. He also expects peace from his people, which in this case is the absence of confusion. But the characteristics of peace in the New Testament is the view of peace as the present possession of the believer. It generally refers to the state of the Christian in this life, as it is used by Jesus in his farewell promise in John chapter 14, verse 27. He says, "My peace I give unto you." Greek-American Bible scholar, the late Dr. Spyros Zodiatis, helped us to understand this further. He writes, "Peace is a tranquil state of the soul, assured of its salvation through Christ, fearing nothing from God, and consequently content with its earthly lot, whatever it is. This is the direct result of redemption by Christ, and consists primarily of a state of conscious reconciliation with God." Peace is perhaps best understood as a state of tranquility where our soul is assured of God's faithfulness in our past, present, and future, and we are also aware of our salvation through Christ and reconciliation with God, that whatever happens, we are in good hands. True peace will come only when we are right with God, when we have laid aside our own ambitions and passions, or at least have them turned over to God. On this second Sunday of the Advent season, we lit the candle of peace. We are reminded that peace is more than what we have attempted to define. Jesus Christ is the Prince of Peace, and that true peace is found only in him. Therefore, when we point others to the Lord Jesus, we are pointing them to the path of true peace, one that is above any definition. We know this, but how do we live it out? For some of us, there are nights when we could not fall asleep. We toss and turn, but just cannot sleep. Our minds are filled with work that needs to be completed and worries of situations that is to come. Our heart rate goes up. Our palms can feel cold. We know something is wrong. But it is nighttime, and everyone else is asleep except me. Sometimes we can cry ourselves to sleep. Other times, we have to depend on medication to help us sleep. In times like that, can we ask for peace? For some of us, we are in constant frustration about the changing circumstances. Our schedules are affected. Our plans can never seem to be fulfilled. Our dreams seem to be put on hold perpetually. In times like that, can we ask for peace? Ever since that dialogue with Mr. Wong in the nursing home, I did not have the opportunity to meet him anymore. If I can meet him again, what would I say to him to help alleviate his worries and anxieties about his children? How about you? Let's say you know of someone like Mr. Wong, who is constantly worried about his circumstances, and what would you say to him or her? It is wise not to only give solutions, because it does not resolve all worries and anxieties. They are just temporal. Rather, we point him or her to the Prince of Peace, our Lord Jesus Christ, the only source of true peace. I'd like to share a story of a man who was searching for the perfect picture of peace. When he could not find one that satisfied, he announced a contest to produce this masterpiece of peace. The challenge caught the imagination of artists everywhere, and paintings arrived from far and wide. Finally, the great day of revelation arrived. The judges uncovered one peaceful scene after another, while the viewers clapped and cheered. The tensions grew. Only two pictures remained viewed. Now, as a judge pulled the cover from one, a hush fell over the crowd. A mirror's smooth lake reflected lacy green birches under the soft blush of the morning sky. Along the grassy shore, a flock of sheep grazed, undisturbed. Surely, this was the winner, the audience thought. The other painting was subsequently uncovered, and the crowd gasped in surprise. Could this be peace? The painting showed a tumultuous waterfall cascading down a rocky cliff. The crowd could almost feel its cold, penetrating spray. Stormy gray clouds threatened to explode with lightning, wind, and rain. In the midst of the thundering noises and bitter chill, a spindly tree clung to the rocks at the edge of the falls. One of its branches reached out in front of the torrential waters and as if foolishly seeking to experience its full power. A little bird had built a nest in the elbow of that branch. Content and undisturbed in her stormy surroundings, she rested on her eggs. With her eyes closed and her wings ready to cover her little ones, she manifested peace that transcends all earthly turmoil. God's faithfulness in the past assures us of our present and future, that in response, our lives may point to the Lord Jesus, the way and source of true peace. Amen. My brothers and sisters in Christ, let us stand and commit this time to God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, you are the God who gives us peace. Regardless of our circumstances or situations, you offer peace that surpasses all understanding. That first Christmas when you sent your Son, you sent the one who is called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. Even the angels cried out, "Glory to God in the highest heaven and on earth, peace to those on whom His favor rests." We are able to have the fullness of peace in our hearts, not only during this Advent season, but every day, because of what your Son, our Lord, has done. He paid the debt of sin and now sits at your right hand in heaven and intercedes for us. He loves us with a love that is unimaginable. Nothing can separate us from His love. So, Father, on this second Sunday of Advent, keep us in perfect peace as our mind is stayed on the truth of your word and amazing love. Thank you for your mighty and sovereign hand. Help us to trust fully in you and rest in the true peace that you offer. We ask this in the name of the Prince of Peace, Jesus Christ. Amen. Please be seated.
And to help us prepare for the Holy Communion, we are going to meditate over the song, What Feast of Love. Incidentally, the song shares the same tune as our previous song, our previous hymn, What Child Is This? And so it forms a very nice continuation of God's salvation plan that starts with what child is this, the birth of Christ, and that leads to the establishment of the communion. So let us meditate over the words of the song as we listen to the communion song today.
In a world full of difficulties, disruption, and disturbances, we long for peace. But the false peace from the world is not what we need. What we need is true peace from God. And we give thanks to God that in response to God's word, and as a follow-up to the lighting of the Advent candle of peace, we are called to the point that God's redemptive work in the past comes to a climax in the birth, in the suffering, the death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ on the cross. And so it is to this recollection of the past that we are all invited to the Lord's table. Because Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, His body was broken for us, and His blood was shed for us on the cross, so that we have true peace from God. And so this is the table of the Lord Jesus Christ, and all those who have been baptized and confirmed in the faith, you're welcome to this table. let us prepare ourselves to receive the Lord's gift. Let us begin. Dearly beloved, and gather on site and online, all that humbly put their trust in Christ and desire his help that they may lead a holy life, and all that are truly sorry for their sins and would be delivered from the burden of them, are invited and encouraged in his name to come to this sacrament. Let us so come that we may find refreshment and rest to our souls. As we draw near to the Lord's table to celebrate the holy communion of the body and blood of the Christ, we gratefully remember that our Lord instituted this sacrament for the perpetual memory of his dying for our sake and the pledge of his undying love. As a bond of our union with him and with each other as members of his mystical body, as a seal of his promises to us, and a renewal of our obedience to him, for the blessed assurance of his presence with us who are gathered here in his name, and as a pledge of his coming again. And now, in his name, I take these elements prepared on site and also prepared by God's people at home to be set apart by prayer and thanksgiving to the holy use for which he has appointed them. Together, O God, who by the life and death and rising again of your dear Son has consecrated for us a new and living way into the holiest of all. Cleanse our minds, we pray, by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that drawing near to you with a pure heart and undefiled conscience, we may receive these your gifts without sin and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is most appropriate that we should always be thanking you, O Lord, for all your gifts to us. But most important of all, we want to praise you for your great love by which you have drawn us to yourself in Christ, for cleansing us from all our sins, for giving us new life by your Spirit, for acknowledging us to be your children, and for giving us the opportunity to serve you all the rest of our lives. Therefore, with the angels and all the saints of all ages and all nations, we praise and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hallelujah. Most gracious God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, whose once offering up of himself upon the cross, we commemorate before you We earnestly desire your fatherly goodness to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Together. And here we offer and present to you ourselves, our souls, and our bodies to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice, completely dedicated to you. Please accept us and continue your work in us until your ultimate purpose is accomplished and we become like Christ. We pray in his name. Amen. On the night on which our Lord Jesus Christ was betrayed, he gathered together with disciples and he took bread. And having given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us rise and remove the top layer. In all the worst striving, it will all lead to a false peace, because true peace can only come from Jesus Christ. For he said, "I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall not hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst." This is the body of Christ broken for us on the cross so that we can go forth in the way of peace. Let us receive this with thanksgiving in our hearts. Please be seated. After the same manner our Savior took the cup, and having given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for the forgiveness of sins." Let us remove the second layer as congregants at home serve the juice or the wine. Let us rise. The way of peace is through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ shed on the cross, because his blood cleanses us from all our sins. This is the blood of Christ shed for us on the cross. Let us receive this with thanksgiving in our hearts. In thanksgiving, let us continue. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Let us confess the Apostles' Creed together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of sins, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Together, Lord, now let your servant depart in peace, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared before the face of all people, to be a light for the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the body and blood of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Strengthen us continually with your Holy Spirit, that we may serve you in faith and love, by word and deed, until at last we come to the joy of your eternal kingdom, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us all remain standing for the hymn of response, and congregants can dispose on the way out. There's a bin on the way out.
Our hymn of response today is, "O Master, Let Me Walk With Thee." So may this prayer be our daily response to God's calling for all of us.
Tell me my secret, help
Let us receive God's blessings. Let us all go forth to walk with the Master in the way of peace. For the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do his will, working in us that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. Let us remain standing for the choral dismissal. Let us all go forth in peace to do the work of God. Let us be seated and let the postlude minister to us to continue our prayer and response to the Lord. After the postlude, anyone who would like the elders or the pastoral staff to pray for you can come forward. Please be seated. We have come to the end of the service. May God's peace be with you this day.